Welcome to Cooksey and the Coach. All right, guys, I've got former RCH team manager, Plano Honda team manager, mechanic for Brian Deegan when he ghosted his bike and won the Supercross, co-founder of the Hart and Huntington Supermoto team, the all-knowing Kenny Watson. What's up, my brother?
Man, you keep changing it every week. My credentials, I like it.
I gotta keep, dude. There's so many credentials to choose for, bro.
I know, but you're not naming them correctly. But that's okay.
Hold on. What did I get wrong?
I didn't find the Supermoto team.
Well, it was Hart and Huntington. You helped found the Hart and Huntington team.
No, not the Supermoto team. I had nothing to do with that. That's when I came to work with them. They had the Supermoto team, and I came to help them.
Well, that whole Donnie, race team Donnie, existed.
Donnie won it. Was the man behind that.
Okay. But
Donnie's the whole one that put that.
Fair enough. Okay. So I just keep making up stuff.
Yeah. And then I wasn't the team manager at RCH. I was the team manager at Hart and Huntington. And then I really didn't have Kyle Bentley became the team manager at RCH because I just knew it would be a little bit more than I could handle and do at that level. So I had to bury my ego a little bit and, you know, say Kyle would do a better job than me and take a step to the side and let him manage that. But I did manage all the activation and marketing and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. So. When I think of the teams, though, when I was at the Supermoto races and Steve Drew was having issues with the AMA, you were the guy that went over there. I remember this clear as day at the South Point. You sat like in the third row, just eyeballed the AMA referee for like 10 minutes. I was like, what's he going to do? Is he going to do something? I thought you were going to kill the guy.
No, they're just.
Do you remember that?
You know, yeah, I do. And, you know, it's kind of funny. I heard like the NFL was talking about how bad the scoring, the referee, you know, how they're calling games. And they even said it there. Like, it's pretty hard to go off on someone when they have a 9-to-5 job during the week, you know, like a professional NFL football referee, they go to work during the week, you know, in the off season, they have jobs. And that's just like our guys. I don't care what you go, if, you know, you're the head of AMA racing, you know, and you have to go to the races every weekend, you probably have another job.
No, I 100% get that.
But it's like when I'm staring someone down, I just get so frustrated saying these people have people's careers in their hand and they're going to make, you know, a justification and make a call that could totally hinder someone's fucking career off of what they do. And it's not going to affect their life at all because they're just going to go to work Monday morning. You know, that's what I used to tell John Gallagher all the time. I go, you're a fucking plumber, dude. You're a fucking plumber. You know, that's all he has to tell him. I go, there's nothing you can do to me, so fuck you, you know. But it's just a hard one to swallow, man. But that's enough for me. Let's talk about the race.
Yeah. What's to talk about? Tomac, whole shot, win. He's great.
We can talk about he rode like a fucking robot. I mean,
dude, a robot.
I would call him Mr. Roboto. I would give him a nickname, Mr. Roboto. And come out to that old Six songs, Mr. Roboto, because he's a robot, dude. He was so on. I mean, dude, he looked fucking flawless.
He was riding that track at the end of that main event like it was just prepped. Like,
dude, unbelievable.
Everyone else is flailing around, and he's just cruising, still jumping everything. I'm like, holy crap, he just dialed in.
Do that one section. It was like a step up into that left-hander.
Oh, that was cool.
Jump down in front of the mechanic. Dude, he was jumping into that berm. Like, there was a little rut. He was jumping into the rut and just freaking pinning it.
Well, you could hear his chain slap every time he did it because he landed on the brakes. And I'm not going to lie. I was secretly hoping for the chain to break right there. And then we throw a wrench into the points. But that's just not happening. Dude, he's going to clinch this thing maybe with 3 rounds to go. I mean, dude. Yeah.
Dude, I mean, who has mud on their face now? All those people were saying, oh, he's going to ride that bike. Oh, my God. He knew something. Everybody else didn't, obviously. I mean, dude, he is gelled to that thing. I don't think there's anyone ever ride that bike better than him out of all those guys that have ridden it.
No, and it's funny. I had Ricky Renner on the show, and him and I both, from the second he signed, said this bike fit him. And
it does. He was such a bigger guy, strong guys. I think it's that bike you have. It has to be on the edge for it to work the way it should work.
Well, see, it's very forgiving as far as the chassis is concerned. And Eli's not the most precise guy in the world. I mean, he's not. You watch him in the rhythm sections on press day, it's not like watching Jean-Michel Bale or somebody. And that bike forgives that. Where the Kawasaki doesn't, you have to be spot on. But when you're spot on, it works really good, which Anderson's always buttering those things on press day. Like, he's that more of a calculated rider. So maybe that's why it works. But
yeah. Well, but just like you said, though, but when you're not on, that Kawasaki's not working the way you want it, where I think it's more manageable for Eli on the Yamaha, where it's manageable for him, you know, because the statue, how his, you know, his body is and how strong he is. You know, we all seen it go really wrong for him on that Kawasaki a few times.
Yeah, and like those whoops tonight, I mean, if you were to hit those on the Kawasaki, it's death compared to what it is on the Yamaha. Oh. I'm not saying it's easy on the Yamaha, but that chassis is just a lot more forgiving.
Yeah, watching that race tonight, I was watching it, and I said, if this dude's carrying this kind of speed indoors, man, it's going to be amazing to see him outside, how fast he's going to be going.
Well, he said the day he got on that bike, he was 2 seconds faster than he was on his Kawasaki race bike outdoors. Keep in mind, he was winning on the Kawasaki when he did that.
I know.
So, yeah, I was, you know, Anderson rode pretty good, got in there for second. I mean, he didn't get the whole shot, but I mean, he's going against, like you said, a robot, but not like a Dungy type robot. This is just a machine, more like the Terminator.
No, we'll give it to him. Ivan Drago, like in Rocky.
Well, we're going to get to that, dude. We're not, you can't call anyone Russian these days. So,
you know what I meant.
Yeah, I know. I know. Yeah. No, he does look kind of like he's built in a factory. But Jason Anderson, I mean, not bad. I mean, he held in there for second. Marvin Musquin did what he does.
I was surprised. I thought Marvin was going to get caught by Mookie. And dude, they just stayed that 2.5-3 second gap the whole race. I was watching it, watching timing and scoring. And, you know, it's, one of those things, like in qualifying, dude, Mookie was fucking on rails. I was like, dude. And then something happened to him in that heat race, dude. He was checked out. And then, dude, he fell back to third. He got third in the heat race. And he never really showed that blistering speed all night. You know, after the heat race, after those, couple laps left, he got passed.
Well, they said he crashed after the finish. I'm wondering if he's got something hurt. And yeah, I don't know. I mean, he did have that nasty crash last week. I don't know if something acted it up. You know, we're doing this 10 minutes after the race, so it's kind of hard to, I'm sure we'll find out what it was. Justin Barcia. Okay. I have a whole theory on this.
Oh, so boy.
The AMA or whoever's building the tracks figured out, don't put tough blocks on the landings of triples, right? Because it's dangerous. Well, the biggest jumps on the track aren't the triples anymore. It's the rhythm sections.
Yeah.
Stop with these fucking tough blocks, man. Are we going to get somebody killed? What do you do? Just for, because they sold a certain amount? Can't we redesign these things to be angled? Or there's got to be a better design.
Well, aren't they? I mean, they're up there for the safety of the riders, too. I think more than not, they have helped a few people landing on them.
I would disagree with that. I think they've caused more crashes than they fix. I mean, yes, it's better than landing on a hay bale, but I mean, how many years have we had tough blocks? You can't tell me that modern science could have made those a little bit better in the last 25 years or whatever we've been using them.
Like, perhaps. You got to
look at it. When you go to Paris, they got those round things and they're angled, so they don't take up track. Cause you think about it, those things are 14 inches wide. So you're taking up, you know, 28 inches of track just putting those out there. We're talking about floor space here. Get them off. You can sell banners. There's got to be a better way to promote. And I know when they do those sales packages, they include a certain amount of tough blocks for each sponsor, which is why they line the entire track with them, because they got to fit them in somewhere. But it's getting to be a hazard. Well, I shouldn't say it's getting to be. It's been a hazard. It's time to step it up and do something else. Maybe put a banner up in that net or something. I don't know.
So do you think Barsha hit that tough block on the way up?
He hit it when he landed? No. He hit it on the way down. He definitely cross-threaded, but he's 6 inches from the edge of the track. If you got a tough block, it takes
so up 14 if he doesn't hit that tough block, where does he end up in that other lane?
No, he could gather it back up.
Well,
put tough block. Okay, that's fine. If that's your theory, put the tough blocks in the middle between the two lanes.
Well, there you go.
You know, or just use one of those big long connecting ones they have, like they drag across the start before the mechanics.
Yeah,
something like that would work great because they're going so fast right now. At some point, someone's going to cross over. We're going to have something nasty. It's not if, it's just when, and it sucks. I hope they would be proactive and do something about that.
No, they don't do that. They don't do nothing. They don't do anything until something happens.
No. That would cost, half of what the firework bill is for one event. So yeah, it is what it is. Cooper Webb. Did you see his practice crash?
Gnarly.
Dude.
Gnarly. And dude, they said he didn't get hurt. I don't know what to say.
He was hurt before the crash, though. I mean, he was hurt from a couple of weeks ago. Can't be
injured. Yeah, right. He's needing this break right now, if anyone is.
Yeah, he's always been good at Seattle. I did expect him to be. I didn't know he was going to eat shit in practice, but I expected him to do well here. But those whoops, man, he didn't even try scamming him. He's like, I'm just jumping him. All moto. Burp, burp, burp. Bogle, dude, coming around. Got an eighth. Looking good.
Yeah. JB rode good, dude. He rode good. He got a good start. I mean, he got eighth and he got lapped.
Well, you got Ivan Drago, the Terminator, coming around. It's just going to happen.
Yeah, I understand, but that still must bum you out. You go, oh, yeah, good ride. You got eighth. And you're like, yeah, cool. But in deep down inside, you know, I got lapped.
Well, deep down inside, you look back and you see who got ninth and tenth. Oldenburg, Hartraft, Chisholm, Starling, Brees. Exactly. Not that those dudes aren't bad dudes, but they're not the level of the guys in front of them. So he was kind of the last big dog. But I don't care. He's also on a Suzuki. As good as that thing looks, and I love the yellow, it's outdated. Looks like a tank out there. It does. It looks big. It looks like he's riding an old bike, you know?
What looks bigger, the bike or the helmet?
The bike. Boy, but nobody's bike looks bigger than Alex Martin's. He looks like he stole his dad's bike. Dude, when he crashed in the whoops, which was a nasty crash.
Oh, dude, you were like, I was running myself. Well, that's so funny you say that because I know where you were going. It's like when I was a little kid and I crashed going up a big uphill, I had to turn the bike around to get my leg over it because I couldn't reach the ground.
Oh, yeah. My dad had a whole system how to drag the bike around and use the hill to get the kickstart. And
my dad too.
Yeah, exactly. That was
him in the whoops. He was trying to find neutral. He was like reaching up for the shifter when he was standing in the low part of the of the whoops.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Hey, the one thing I was glad to see, though, and it's about time they pulled the plug on Chase Sexton. This has been disastrous these last few weeks, man. And you can't tell me those hits to the head haven't affected him. Either his confidence or something.
You ever see that? Remember that old commercial when they show that egg cracking? You ever see that thing? Yeah, it's like an egg, and they throw it against the wall, and they say, that's what happens when you hit your head. And I just think about that all the time.
Yeah,
dude, I don't know if he's a crash test dummy. Is he doing some like R&D for A-Star and saying, hey, I'm gonna be eating shit? God, he's hit the ground hard a lot, dude. A lot. I feel bad for the dude.
He's taking this airbag data to a next level. So, because they're working on it. A-Star has sensors on a lot of these guys testing to see so they can use those MotoGP airbags on these riders. And they've got to be getting some good data from Chase.
So. Yeah, for sure. So what, when they hit the ground, just an airbag pops out?
Well, if you watch the MX or the MotoGP road racers, when they come off the bike, an airbag pops. So when they hit the sand trap, they've been really beneficial. But the problem with motocross is there's so many hard hits that aren't even crashes. Like, you can't have an airbag going off over the triple, you know?
Yeah.
So, but they're trying to get enough data to make it work. I don't know if it'll ever happen or not, but if they do, that'd be badass. So.
Yeah, for sure.
Anything else on the 450s before we move to the 250s?
450s, anything exciting? I just thought it was a pretty, you know, it was a pretty boring race, though.
It was, and I don't even, yeah, I don't want to say it was boring, because anytime I watch Supercross, it's awesome. We've been spoiled lately, man. Every race has been like the best race I've ever seen. And
I mean, now I like watching those dudes in the LCQ though, Carnal and Playston and all those dudes. They're a clown show.
Even the battle, like in the heat race when they're going for ninth and what's his name? Morantz just creams Clayson, and then they get up and then he's racing Tristan Lane and he still gets in. I was like, yeah, good on Clayson. That was badass.
How did Tristan Lane not get in?
He got in after the LCQ, but when those guys went down?
Yeah, but I thought he went into ninth.
He kind of went into ninth, but Clayson was right next to him and just sent it through the whoops and got back around him.
I thought there was two positions there. I thought there was eighth and ninth. Oh, no, A-Ray was in eighth.
Yeah, that was ninth and tenth. So.
Wow.
Yeah, good stuff.
Yeah, it was what's your guy with the girl sponsorship? He didn't get in, huh?
Oh yeah, Logan Carnow and his girl, Hannah Ray. So if you guys want to check her out, that's Hannah Ray on Instagram.
She crushed it.
Dude, she totally crushed it. She got 500 new subscribers, like $10 a pop or something.
Wow,
yeah, it was well worth it. So I hope more girls out there, if you're on OnlyFans, I don't know if you probably, I'm sure they don't listen to our show, but if anyone knows any girls on OnlyFans, tell them to go sponsor some riders. Let's get some money out there. Sponsor a team. There we go.
How much do you think she paid him?
Between 2,000 and 5,000 per round.
Okay.
Is what my guess is. I don't know for sure. And I text Carnal and I haven't heard back yet. So we'll see. I mean,
well, you know, as long as she gets an ROI on it, you know.
Oh, her ROI is through the roof. I think she could sponsor him the rest of it after what she got just off the memberships from the 1 week. So
cool.
Or 17. Right on. And, you know, then they throw her tips and just the overall exposure for a girl in that industry. Perfect, dude. Mainstream exposure.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty. I mean, I was surprised that, you know, they plugged it on TV.
Yeah, yeah. And who's hornier than a bunch of dudes watching dirt bikes? I mean, that's why we have Monster Girls and all that stuff. Like, of course, literally, that's their market. Like, that's literally the best marketing anyone could have for that. Dude, I
agree with you. And I always wonder what happened to that guy that used to make those calendars. Like, someone needs to come back with the moto chicks for calendars. Every guy wants one of those in his garage working on bikes.
Yeah.
I always say that sex sells. Like, how bitching, you know, I always say that. Like, do a photo shoot. Every team should do a photo shoot with the chick at the race, like, you know, before it in the studio, and then give them away at the races. Because most guys, older people, are going to put up a poster of a chick next to a motorcycle than they are, you know, of an 18-year-old boy standing next to his bike.
Yeah, I hate to say it, though, Kenny. We're victims of the woke culture and these leftist jackasses that would rather see a guy dressed as a girl break swim records. So,
yeah, but, I'll have to agree with that. I like that, too.
Yeah. Okay, 250s. Mosman, he came to race tonight. He was.
Woo!
I like that Mosman and Hunter both. They're not settling. They're like, listen, we're gonna put it to him. And you know, just because everyone says Christian's so fast, blah blah blah, we're not gonna lay over. And what did you think of the move where Mosman hit Craig?
That was racing. I don't think he took him out. Craig could have brake checked. He could have hit the brakes. He didn't even hit him. It looks like Craig turned down on him.
I 100% agree. I think Mosman has been more than kind throughout the year. I think it was Anaheim 2 where I said Mosman should have sent him over the berm and he didn't. And then this one, I looked at it and I was like, what's Craig doing? Like he, if you're that much faster or, you know, you got these guys covered, like he kind of does, why not? Why not lay up, jump in behind him like Jet would have done, like Jet did with McAdoo, give it a couple laps and pass him back.
Or not even pass him back. Who cares? You got, you know, you got good points right there. He still got exactly what would have happened if he didn't pass him.
Yeah.
You know, he got second and, you know, and without taking all those chances he had to take.
Well, and I believe Hunter was in second in the points. So, yeah, you probably still would have gapped your point lead. You'd probably have 30 instead of 28. So,
yeah, it was, McAdoo, it looked like he went backwards after that.
Oh, yeah, Mosman.
Mosman.
He couldn't figure out what was going on with his rear brake. He kept losing his rear brake. He bent the rotor when he hit Craig, which, if you're going to have contact, that can happen. That's, you run those risks. That's, you hit a guy, you bend a rotor. It's just what happens.
Yeah, and it was his back brake. So that tells you he didn't hit him with his front wheel.
Correct. Yeah.
So then you can't say he took him out. When he took him out with his back wheel, that means someone hit him from the back.
Listen, I'd said last week the move that Barcia did on Anderson was dirty. This was not dirty. This was hard racing, and Craig needs to know better. And
he was talking like, you know, it was dirty. He didn't say it. He just said, you know, he made it sound like, you know, he took a cheap shot at him. Well, I didn't agree. You know, I don't think he did. And I like Christian, and I just don't think that that he took a cheap shot at him. I like we talked earlier, I just think it was an aggressive move.
Yeah. I absolutely agree.
Not drives me crazy, but really I think it's kind of like weird a little bit, is that Mosman kid, he's like the nicest Christian boy off the bike, and he's such a nice guy, but you bolt that helmet on that kid, he's at a different level, man. That kid is just, he, like you said, he comes to the races to race. He's not afraid, you know. He throws it out there
kind of like a guy, Andrew Short back in the day, you know, the smiley faced assassin.
Oh yeah. And I remember, it's funny, I was working some deals with his dad way back in the day, like when he was just turning pro. And
Mosman?
I remember his dad telling me, like, you know, he was going to get they wanted to keep him down a year, and Roger had big plans for him. Roger really, like, believes in him, and, you know, they really think he's in. And he wasn't doing anything, really, at the amateur level back then. Like, he wasn't, like, one of the top guys. He was there, but I don't think he went out and set the world on fire. And I was like, really? And I thought his dad was just joking, you know, talking crap.
Yeah.
But, dude, it's proving that he's, you know, getting the job done. You know, how does he do outdoors, Mosman?
Really good. He's won a couple nationals, or one at least. So, yeah, he's cool. He's good outdoors. I will say this about Mosman. Hearing about the story where he had the homeless guy staying in his room with him.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Seems a little weird to me. Like I feel like he's so nice, but he could have like body parts in his trunk of his car. Like, he definitely creeps me out a little bit. And I don't know him very well, but when somebody's...
We're going to make new nicknames for all the riders. He's going to be Dahmer.
Right? Like, if somebody told me he was a murderer, I would be like, that seems That's about right to me.
Yeah, so. Exactly.
But I could be way off. He's just a nice guy. But we're just...
Yeah, he's a... Oh, God.
Okay, hold on. Back to the podium with Craig. I cannot... Listen, I love when guys show emotion. And I want guys to go up there. And if he's pissed about the pass, whether it was a bad move or not, I love when guys tell us what they think. And he told us what we thought. He came off a little bitchy, but I don't care. I love it. I thank Christian Craig for that, and I commend him.
No, I think he did the right thing. But, you know, just like Mosman. Mosman did the same exact thing. And, dude, he just had a smile on his face the whole time. You know, he was just, always. You always get a good interview out of that guy.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, he just puts Craig down, smashes his rotor, loses a win, and he smiles like everything's all good. That's why I think he could have bodies in his trunk and he'd be smiling.
So, yeah. Oh, God. Right on. Yeah.
About Nate Thrasher, he looked really good early, and then he just came apart.
Yeah. Well, you know, in that lights class, I just got one thing to say. They fight better than the 450 guys.
Oh, yeah. We're going to get to that. So, okay, we'll just go straight to the LCQ fight. That was a good fight. And that knee was like a legit knee. Like, that's what you do when a dude's on the ground like that. You throw a knee. You don't throw a punch. And
yeah, you don't hurt your hands.
Exactly, exactly. And he didn't hit him in the helmet. He hit him in the shoulder, like hit him in the unprotected areas. But do you think it was because we all glamorized the crash and the fight the week before that they kind of wanted to get a little attention? Or was this organic?
No, no. He got cleaned out, that dude. He was pissed.
Oh, he got smashed. He definitely got smashed.
And I like him. He was flipping him off in his face, and the TV showed it twice. I was like, whoa. Cool.
That was dude, pretty so, cool.
I think the promoters are just, and TV's just like rubbing their hands together. Man, we got some good stuff.
Yeah, they're probably like, hey, advertising. Please don't find these guys very much because we really like this. This is good. It's good, man. That's what racing is. You go to the tracks. I can't tell you how many issues I've had with people, and it's just, you're riding, you're fighting, you're going for everything you can. You're running your temperatures. Just you're right at the edge. So something happens. Yeah, you're going to flip somebody off. Are you guys probably going to have a beer after? Most likely. Sometimes you want to murder them, you know? Yeah. Just ask Mosman. So.
Yeah, exactly. They do all that crap, and then it's the heat of the moment, and a month later, you know, it's like they're high-fiving each other, laughing about it, you know? Dude,
when I was a kid, I just moved up to 80 expert. I was 12 going against all these 15-year-olds. There was a kid by the name of Matt Smith. This dude cleaned me out probably 8 weeks in a row. I paid my brother to kick his ass. If somebody would have murdered him, I would have paid them to. It happens. But then again, I saw him with his kid racing BMX. And it's just funny. We laugh about it later on. It's just what it is. It's the sport, man.
That's awesome. You paid your brother to beat him up.
Meanwhile, he probably would have, like, my brother didn't actually beat him up. He went and had words with him, and I didn't end up paying him. But truth be told, my brother probably would have got beat up by Matt. Matt was pretty tough. So,
yeah. So you this is probably what happened. You probably said, I'm going to pay you to go beat him up. Your brother goes over there, gets beat up by that guy, then comes back and beats you up.
Yeah, that's my brother laid a lot of weapons on me. So
that's the way a lot of shit works out.
Yeah, I never paid him. He probably beat me up because I never paid him. So yeah.
But getting back to the lights race, you know, it just seems like it's really thin in that, you know, the top five. It's like Joe didn't really do much. Shimoda, he was kind of quiet tonight. I don't know if he's riding hurt or what's the deal. You know.
Yeah, I expect more out of Marchbanks there.
Oh, so did I. I was thinking about that. I was thinking about, you know, how the track was going to be ready. He's from Salt Lake, you know, and he's down there, Shannon, and, you know.
Club MX.
Yeah, whatever it is. He's down there doing his thing. So, man, he didn't show anything. But your boy did. Freezy,
yeah, he won the heat race, ended up fifth.
Yeah, good for him.
Yeah, and then your boy Blos, seventh, not bad.
Yep, on his way out.
That's all right, dude. That's pretty well. I mean, another guy I was disappointed in, who I really like, is Julik Swole. I figured, you know, he called it the reset. He was going to come back. I expected him to get back up into that top five in battle. I don't know what happened to him, but he was eighth.
What did he get? Eighth?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not doing him any good.
Well, and you know who else looked pretty good? And I just noticed the Suzukis because I feel like they're riding at a handicap. And they're probably not. They're probably good bikes. It's just my bias. Mumford looked really good.
I think it was the first time in his Supercross career where he got really to run up front and see what the pace is. In the heat race.
Yeah.
But after that, in the main, he just got a freaking terrible start. He started on the inside, got the jump, but he still got he still got stuffed in the corner of the first turn and he couldn't weasel his way around. And, you know, I think, what do you get, 12th, 11th or 12th?
12th. Yeah. And on a track like that, where it gets so chewed up, if you go behind a guy in a rut and that guy has a problem, you're screwed. It's not like a track where there's not ruts where you can go all over and make passes.
Yeah.
You're kind of screwed.
He's learning. That kid's learning. I mean, he's still young. He's just learning. Last year was a wash for him. You can't even count that. You have to count this year as his rookie season and, you know, make every main, do all the laps, maybe go out and lead a few laps, you know, get comfortable with it. You know, I'm expecting him to do better outdoors than, you know, indoors. I think the Suzuki outdoors, you know, it's proved itself with Schwartz last year.
Yeah. It looks pretty good outdoors. And I think the thing about the Suzuki is not, I don't know, I think they got enough power out of it. And I think they've shaved some weight. It's just not as nimble in those really tight sections to me.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's, you know, one of those deals. It's like, they've had that bike for so long and they've done so much R&D on it. Like, you know, it should be fast by now, you know?
Yeah. But yeah. It's what you start with too. I mean, if you start with a newer design, you do more. Yeah. It is.
Yeah.
What it is.
For sure.
Beating a dead horse here. Anything else on the 250s? Before we move on to some stuff I have some issues with.
I don't think so. I think all in all, you know, it was, the first time in a while that the light spots was a little bit more exciting than the other one, you know, having to see, Craig come from the back and all that, but all in all, it was just you know, I thought it wasn't too exciting. I mean, it had its moments, but just like you said, I think we're spoiled.
Yeah, well, I'm excited to see what happens. We got a triple crown in St. Louis in 2 weeks, and then after that, they go to Atlanta for the East West. So it's like, just as it starts to get boring, we got some cool stuff. But they hold it out a week, we're all going to be dying to see it. It's just. It is what it is.
I mean, it'll be cool for the lights, but the 450, I mean, dude, out of the top six, there's, you know, really nothing. I mean, you got Dino. There's seven factory guys there. I counted them. You know what I mean?
Benny Bloss is supposed to come back at St. Louis. And he's not, I know he's not factory, but he's pretty good. He's one of those guys that can run up there.
Yeah.
Brayton will maybe come back. I don't know. I think Benny Bloss has got his own program.
Okay.
No, he's Team Tedder, because he was Josh Hill filled in for him. So, okay, so that's it for these guys. I have some issues right now in the worlds of racing and life. And we're going to get a little bit political here, Kenny. This idea of banning Russians from competing in sports is ridiculous. Borbachev, the MXGP rider, is over here living in Florida, training at the Baker's Factory or training with the Lawrence brothers and hanging out. Yet he can't get a pro license because he's Russian right now. That's ridiculous. What is wrong with people?
Wait, he was going to ride.
He's going to ride some nationals.
Oh, wow.
But he can't get an AMA pro license. It's not just AMA. Moto, like all the GPs are doing it. I'm like, what is wrong with people? We're now going to penalize every Russian person for what their dumbass president does. Like, are you serious? You think, how does this make it better? What is, you know, Borbachev, Russian Bob, what is punishing him from riding an outdoor national? What does that solve?
As I understand, most of the Russians aren't even supporting what this guy's doing.
Yeah, you know? Clearly he's over here right now.
I mean, that's a perfect example. I mean, him saying, yeah, you know, I'm Russian, but why do you think I'm here? I don't support that bullshit, you know?
And even if they do support that bullshit, as long as I don't have a problem. So now if he goes there and makes a political statement at the race, yeah, pull the license. But if he just goes there and does racing, this whole sport is to take us away. Almost like a melting pot. Like let's go be people. This is entertainment. This is fun. And now you guys are going to start drawing lines between what their government does. If this guy who has no say whatsoever in any invasions anywhere can't go racing, it's ridiculous.
I think they watch a little much too much Red Dawn.
right? Oh, it's ridiculous. Okay, so I'm glad you think it's as dumb as I do.
Yeah, but it's one of those things that you and me ain't gonna make the difference. We're not gonna. There's nothing we can change. You know,
oh, we could voice our opinions, put it out there. How ridiculous it is. The UFC has recognized it. They're not doing it. They're letting the Russian fighters fight.
And I watched a Russian guy fight tonight.
Yeah. And did you see how bad he got booed? Which is fine. Mm-hmm. That's it. It's just sport. So by booing the Russian guy.
You think we should get Jeremy Albrecht on the show and ask him about that?
Please, 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 please. Yes. If anyone in the AMA will talk to me. But Jeremy's not handling. Okay. There's where it gets tricky. Jeremy has nothing to do with outdoor motocross. Outdoor motocross is MX Sports because it's AMA Pro Racing, not the AMA. Two totally separate organizations.
Yeah, but the guy that he works with, the head of AMA Pro Racing?
Jeff Canfield?
Is that who it is, Canfield?
They said Jeff Canfield was there talking with him, which Jeff Canfield has an MX Sports email. So who's he work for?
Yeah.
Let's get Jeremy Albrecht on here. I would love, let's say if Russian Bob wants to, and I apologize, I don't know how to say his name, Borbachev Ivanji. I'm sorry, I just keep butchering it, so I'm gonna call him Russian Bob, which is what most people have called him. If he wants to race a supercross, would Jeremy Albrecht go to bat for him? That'd be a good question. So let's get him on here, let's find out. And then I have another theory. Part of the reason I think the racing was bad, Kenny, is the tracks break down. These bikes make so much power. They shred it. Have you ever heard stop me if I've told you this about my theory on knobbies. I believe that we need to go with some enduro tires, like the tires they use in the Europe for the EPA reasons, so they don't tear up the trails. And I talked to I talked to Brock Glover at Dunlop. He said within a year or two, they could have a production tire that hooked up almost as good as the tires they have right now. And yes, it had a limited knob height of like a 3/4 inch or something like that. And now the tracks will hold up. No?
I don't believe it. I just think they're still going to break down. They're still going to break down. They're still going to get ruts from the weight of the bike.
But it's getting worse every year because pretty much every dude right now runs a paddle tire. Those big old razors on the back. They're starting to look like the treads they put on snowmobiles, those tracks that are like a chainsaw.
Yeah.
That's where we're headed. And I'm saying before we get there, you know, and then it makes power less of an issue. It's kind of, I don't know. I would like to see it tried, but that's one of my crazy theories. So that's it.
Another theory that I think it's a good theory, but nothing's going to change. That dirt that they have there in Seattle is probably the dirt they had there from the Silver Dome when they blew it up. Not the Silver Dome, the King Dome when they blew it up. You know,
probably.
I mean, probably. And then the next thing you're going to say is, well, I think we should make them into the rhythm lanes and the whoops in concrete so they don't break down.
No. You use a smaller knob, so you don't have to put concrete in them. Or we have lime gate like we had at San Diego.
That was awesome.
Dude, that was not awesome. Were you working with the team when that happened?
No.
Oh, well, it's funny all the lawsuits and people burning their balls, and it just went away. I never heard anything about it. Yeah.
Lime dirt?
Yeah. Well, and I remember there was a pile of, they say it wasn't lime. They said it was dirt, but it was white. And they just dumped it in that puddle in the start straight. I was like, ooh. Yeah. So I talked to my source with Honda, Roczen. So they tried to get Hunter on the bike. Hunter wanted to ride that bike outdoors, thinking Kenny wasn't coming back. HRC said, no, absolutely not. Kenny's coming back for outdoors. I'll be shocked if that happens, knowing how they parted. But that's what they're saying.
Huh. And yeah. Then, I know that they're all still hanging out. Like, he's still hanging out with management and shit, you know, like away from work.
So maybe it's salvageable. I don't know, at least for the rest of this year.
And I don't think Kenny's issue is with the people that he works with every day. I think it's more of, you know, Japan. And I think it's more with HRC over, you know,
Well, and that's what I was told. The email came from HRC that Kenny will be outdoors. So we'll see. Jet is going to be on that bike for the second half of next year. I actually reported all last year, but I had it wrong. So Jet is, obviously, if he wins the outdoor title, Jet will be defend the Supercross title if he can close it out. And then he's going to ride whichever coast he's not on, a couple 450 rounds, and then he's going 450 outdoors 2023. That's the plan.
Huh.
I like it. I think it's a good plan. I think he's ready, in my opinion, for that, especially if they break him in easily. And they kind of did that with Sexton.
So they're going to – he's not going to touch the 450. He's not going to touch the 450 outdoors until he lines up to race the series?
Correct.
Gotcha.
I mean, he'll have time to prep on it and stuff, but
– Yeah.
Much like how Sexton – you know how Sexton did it?
Yeah.
Yeah, how he just started with the outdoors. It's just – rather than start with Supercross, start with outdoors. It's just easier to get used to that bike out there. Okay, we already covered Stank Dog getting a little close. He was up there. Was he
riding 250?
Stank, yeah, 252 stroke. And he's getting close, man. I really want him to make history.
He was right there, and he must have fallen or something.
Yeah. He was within two guys,
he was in six, and then all of a sudden I seen him just drop back like four positions. And there were the guys that passed him. I'm like, no, he could beat them on a two stroke.
Yeah. Okay. All right, Kenny, are you ready for one more theory of mine?
You got me, dude. Let's do it. Let's hear it.
I'm tired of these knuckleheads out there waving their
every which way. Did I lose you?
No.
Okay. I'm tired of these knuckleheads out there waving blue flags, acting like the riders can see. They don't know who's coming up on them. In this day and age, we've got remote technology. I could literally be sitting in the stands, flip a switch, and all of a sudden you'll see a blue light go on the handlebar. That's it.
Well, they got every other switch on the handlebar. What's another switch on there?
No. Just put a little light on there. Put it in the bar pad. Dude, they're so small these days. So
I like that idea.
And then I don't have to have five dudes out there waving a blue flag in danger on the track. They could just be a few rows up. And just let the guys know. As soon as that blue goes on, you know, oh, shit, that guy coming on me, that's not the guy I'm battling. That's the leader.
Yeah, a lot more accurate. And then you can justify, you know, if you penalize someone for not getting out of the way.
Correct. Yeah. Say your handlebar, dude. If you didn't see that, that's your fault.
Yeah. And then they could have a data logger to show them, hey, look at right here on lap so and so is when we hit the light. You didn't get out of the way. So, you know, you're docked or you're fined or whatever they love to do to hurt people's pockets.
Well, stop fining these guys. You can't fine anyone you don't pay. That's bullshit. That's just stealing. And they don't pay them shit. So you can't claim the money that comes from the teams. That has nothing to do with the fines. Fines come out of the purse, which we all know what a joke that is.
Yeah. What happens to that money? They say it goes to
the Alpine Star. Alpine Star Road to Recovery. I would be suspect. I'd like to follow that. I'd like to follow that money and see where it really goes.
Yeah.
But then again, they don't find a whole bunch. So I don't know. But Kenny, anything else on the on tonight's pod, or should we wrap this bad boy?
I just think we're going to be rambling.
Fair enough.
I just think we had a good little chat. Everything seemed up and up and made sense. Everything you said. We'll let you guys know if I can get J-Bone for next week, and we'll pick his brain a little bit.
Yeah, let's do it. I don't know if you can during the week at all. I don't know what you're doing these days. By the way, you want to update people? How you feeling, brother? People are worried about you.
Okay.
Okay.
Not great. I got a long road ahead of me, put it that way.
Hey, you're still there, though. If you're still there, you're still here to hear my stupid theories, and we're good. All right, guys, I want to thank Coach Rob. One of these days we'll get him back on. Tonight when the West Coast wins, he's resting because he's probably running a triathlon or something tomorrow. So thanks to Complete Racing Solutions, that's where you can find him and his programs, his energy fuel, and all that. So anyway, Kenny, thank you, my brother. You have a good Saturday night.
You too, buddy. Good talking to you.